I'm moving out this week on another episode of Military Collectors. In case you missed it last week, the world's largest collection of artillery and armored pieces in Danville, Virginia. Well, we're still there, and we're going to take a look at a lot more, 300,000 square feet of military collectibles on Military Collectors this week.
Roger that.
Welcome to this week's episode of Military Collectors. You know, we're here at the American Armor Foundation Tank Museum in Danville, Virginia. And if you didn't have a chance to see last week's show, well, listen, from the enormity of a collection of Karen and William Gasser, they've turned it over to their kids now, Dan and Doug, and Dan's wife, Natasha, and they run this 300,000 square foot cavalry and armored collection, the largest in the world in civilian hands. And I can tell you, I just didn't think that one show would do it justice. And so we come back this week. I mean, last week it was 30,000 collectibles. It was 120 tracked and armament vehicles. I mean, it was flamethrowers. And if you want to see more of it, just log on to militarycollectorstv.com and you can go see that episode last week. But we're back here now, and I've got Dan Gasser here. And Dan, you know, again, thank us so much for having us back. You know, I mean, gosh, your mom and dad are just so special people. You and your brother now have kind of got the reins with your wife that run this place. But, you know, on this week's show, I wanted to ask you, what was one of the most favored pieces of your dad's collection, okay? And this is where we end up. Tell me about this, okay?
It's a World War I tank, 6-ton special. It's off of the French version. The U.S. versions never actually saw combat, okay? So this was not a combat vehicle, at least that we know of, okay? We're estimating there's about 6 in the world that we know of, okay? So they're very rare, extremely hard to come by. We've probably got this one 35 years ago, easy. You know, I think it came from Montana, if I remember correctly. And they must have found it in some salvage yard somewhere, just sitting there rusting away, you know?
Like, well, you know, that's what's so unique about the museum here is the way your dad has acquired all these different pieces, okay? And it's still, I mean, you know, once a hoarder and a collector, always a collector.
Absolutely.
But my goodness, I mean, this, again, as he told us, was one of his most valued, other than the Panzer tank, okay, which we did the interview with both of them.
Correct.
But, you know, tell me, what would be the value of owning one of 6 in the world?
As much as you can get for it. You know, I mean, unfortunately, it's the marketplace, you know what I mean? So you just gotta throw a number and hope it sticks. As far as a number value, how much do you wanna let it go for? You know, I mean, it's just so valuable. You know, it's so valuable, and once it's gone, it's gone. You're never gonna get another one, you know, so.
Well, now, let me ask you, now this one is in the state in which you found it, obviously. Of course, it's not, the paint's not correct. I guess it is under here, but not that. But is it more valuable as a collector to leave it this way or to restore it?
It goes both ways. Restorations, in theory, if you are restoring it, you are messing with the originality of it, okay? So if you want the pristine of it, you want it to look beautiful, then you'd restore it. In this condition, it shows you what it actually came to us as, okay? So this is the paint, you know, I mean, this is what it looked like. You look inside, that's what it was, you know? So certain things, you're better off just not leaving it, just leaving it alone. You know, make it like the barn find, you know? In my value, something that's not touched is worth more, okay? When it's in good condition, okay?
Well, you know, and the folks that come through here, okay, the hundreds of thousands of people, and again, tell all the folks about the visitation hours, okay? Because I know they can go to your website, and of course they can go to ours, but just tell about the hours of operation, okay? I've got to be able to do that because, you know, folks, you got to understand that you need to bring the kids. They need to see history right here. And not many collections are left like this in the world, especially in the United States.
Right. Yeah.
So tell me a little bit about the hours of operation here.
We're open Fridays and Saturdays from 10 to 4. Average visitor spends 2 to 4 hours minimum in the building, okay? It's a lot of walking, you know, so. And then up to January, February, and March, we're only open on Saturdays because there is no heat or air conditioning in the building. So the diehards that want to wear your winter coats and freeze with us, come on out, you know? But admission price is $12 for adults, $10 for children, you know, so it's a steal.
Next on Military Collectors, we take a look at the extensive uniform collection from all over the world from the AAF Tank Museum in Danville, Virginia. Military Collectors is brought to you today by GovPlanet, your online auction site for government equipment, by Chevrolet, Chevrolet, find new roads, and by the South Carolina National Guard Museum. Discover the Palmetto State's military history. How would you like to be an owner of military history? A real military Humvee? In sponsorship with GovPlanet, here's your chance to own a military Humvee for display or recreation. It's simple. All you have to do is visit winahumvee.com and register today. It's that easy. Don't wait. Register today at winahumvee.com. Winahumvee.com is being brought to you by GovPlanet, your online auction site for government surplus. Northside, performance outdoor footwear for the whole family.
How's it going?
Hi.
Today we're going to be comparing the roll-formed, high-strength steel bed of the Chevy Silverado to the aluminum bed of this competitor's truck.
Awesome. All right, let him drop.
Let's see how the aluminum bed of this truck held up.
Wow. That's a good-sized puncture.
That's all the way through, for sure.
Full-on crack here.
You're aluminum now, you're gonna go, ooh.
Let's check out the Silverado steel bed.
Wow. Yeah, a couple dents.
I'd expect more dents.
Chevy clearly held up better than the Ford.
Buckham.
Hi.
Today we're gonna be comparing the roll-formed, high-strength steel bed of the Chevy Silverado to the aluminum bed of this competitor's truck.
Nice.
Wanna grab that empty toolbox for me? Let's start here with the aluminum bed.
That's a big hole.
Huge.
We got Swiss cheese for a truck here.
I'm curious to see if that will do the same thing with the Chevy.
Well, let's find out. Same spot, same angle, same empty toolbox.
Took it way better.
The steel held up.
Silverado proved it is the toughest truck here.
Roger that.
Welcome back to this week's Military Collectors. We're here at the American Armor Foundation Tank Museum in Danville, Virginia. Again, if you missed our show last week, you missed an action-packed show, but we're back here because, again, there's just too much to show you in a 30-minute TV show on Military Collectors. So, we're here in the Hall of Generals. And I will tell you that the Gassers have amassed over 30,000 small artifacts. This is called the Hall of Generals. There are generals' uniforms, the actual uniforms that have been donated by the actual officers from all over the world, to include U.S. military general officers, right here in Danville, Virginia. And joining me again is Dan Gasser. Dan, I will tell you know, on this segment of the show, let's really talk about the enormity of what you have here, okay? I mean, I noticed General Wickham, General Abrams. Mm-hmm. I mean, you've got World War II generals. I mean, Korea. I mean, you've got foreign general officers here. I mean, how many are here?
We're about a little over 400. You know, on display, probably another 40 or so that are still in storage, ready to go out. We just haven't made it to it yet. You know, most of them are all named. Well, they are all named. They have data sheets, histories, all that archived on them, so the guests could know what they're looking at, you know.
Well, they're all, though, the connectivity, though, is they all served, they either had armor or cavalry. Associated with their career at some point. Because,
yeah.
Again, when they pin on general officer rank, then off goes their branch and insignia, and then they pin on the stars, and so then they become everything. So, but that's primarily the focus here. Now, correct. I also noticed that you have a foreign from different countries. Mm-hmm. Of course, in World War II, most famed is looks to be Germany.
We have a Rummel, we have Meinstein, you know, Rummel's probably the bigger name, okay, it's a prized one just because you can't find them, okay, you don't have that option of ever seeing another one. When it comes past your door, you just got to jump on it, you know, because you'll never have that opportunity again.
Well, Speaking of that, of the Germans, okay, because I know the Panzer tanks. I mean, I know early on in the collection, your dad had a passion for collecting the German armor pieces as well, and sure. and artillery. Does he have a favorite? Do you guys have a favorite uniform general? Out of all these 400, what is the most famous?
Probably the Roman uniform.
Really?
Yeah, just because it's so hard to come by. You know, you just said you'll never see another one. You know, as far as history-wise goes, it's a big name. Okay, everybody knows the name. Okay, so when you look in the history books, it comes back for tank. Okay, it comes back all the time.
So even more than Patton.
You know, well, we don't have a patent.
Okay.
Okay. We have not been able to even come close to getting one.
We
have tried and tried and tried and just have not been able to get to that one. If you could get one, it's like the Holy Grail. You
right.
know, just have not been able to find one.
Well, all you collectors out there, take note. The AAF Tank Museum here would gladly appreciate
Absolutely.
Some mm-hmm. patent stuff. And I'm sure it's out there, okay? Mm-hmm. And you guys do take donations just like this.
Absolutely,
And
yes.
you put them all on display for everybody in the viewing of the public. So Absolutely. I think that's a great thing. Okay, I'm gonna ask you, can we go see this Rommel?
Absolutely.
Uniforms?
Absolutely. Let's go take a look.
And let's do it.
When we come back, we take a look at a uniform from one of the most famous generals of World War II. If you're in the market for military surplus for recreation or construction, or you just want to own a piece of military history, go online to GovPlanet.com's weekly auction. GovPlanet has auctions every Wednesday, where you can find and bid on numerous items. All items are protected by ironclad assurance, which makes sure that what's in GovPlanet's report is what you're getting. Be sure to join GovPlanet every Wednesday for their weekly auction, and check in often to see their ever-changing inventory. GovPlanet, your online auction site for government equipment. Northside, performance outdoor footwear for the whole family.
How's it going?
Hi.
Today we're going to be comparing the roll-formed, high-strength steel bed of the Chevy Silverado to the aluminum bed of this competitor's truck.
Awesome.
All right, let him drop.
Let's see how the aluminum bed of this truck held up.
Wow. That's a good-sized punch here.
That's all the way through, for sure.
Full-on crack here.
If you're aluminum now, you're gonna go, ugh.
Let's check out the Silverado steel bed.
Wow.
Yeah, a couple dents.
I'd expect more dents.
Chevy clearly held up better than the Ford.
How would you like to be an owner of military history? A real military Humvee? In sponsorship with GovPlanet, here's your chance to own a military Humvee for display or recreation. It's simple. All you have to do is visit winahumvee.com and register today. It's that easy. Don't wait. Register today at winahumvee.com. Winahumvee.com is being brought to you by GovPlanet, your online auction site for government surplus.
Roger that.
And look, okay, we're here. This has got to be one of the favorite of not only your dad, but of the folks that come here to the museum. Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit about, you know, I'm amazed, okay, mm-hmm. Rommel, okay? I mean, we all seen the movie Patton. We saw all of the theatrics by George T. Scott. But this is the first time I've ever seen a Rommel uniform, okay? And I've been in a lot of museums. How did you get this?
It came through a collector that we know very well, you know, friend of the family, basically, that was able to acquire it. Been looking for them for years, trying to get it. And like you said, you don't see them.
No.
So when you do come across it, you gotta jump, you know. I think there's maybe five that are even known to exist.
Now, okay. Most of them in Europe, in Germany?
Most of them in private collections all over the place.
Really?
Okay, they're never on display. Most people that have them don't even show them. It's just a personal connection, okay? You know, we wanted to show it because this is a huge part of history. You got to know this name, you know what I mean? So
yeah. You
can't forget about this one, because most people do know, okay? You know, so, you know, had a huge part in the history of it, so that's why we have it on display here.
Well, your dad has to be really proud of. I mean, tell me about this, of course, the white, is this the white dress?
Yeah, that'd be his white suit. It's got his name written on the tag, inside of it.
Wow.
It's got its metals, you know. As far as we can tell, everything is correct on it.
Is okay? Correct.
You know, same deal with his desert uniform, you know. I mean, medallion on it, priceless. You know, find another one, because you won't. We've been looking forever.
I am just really blown away because, again, one of the most famed generals of World War II, even though he was German.
Yep.
I've never seen it before. So, and it's right here at the American Armor Foundation Tank Museum, and I will tell you, it's just fantastic.
Stay tuned next on Military Collectors. We see a different collectible that involves tanks and tank battles. Military Collectors is brought to you today by GovPlanet, your online auction site for government equipment. By Chevrolet. Chevrolet, find new roads. And by the South Carolina National Guard Museum. Discover the Palmetto State's military history. How would you like to be an owner of military history? A real military Humvee? In sponsorship with GovPlanet, here's your chance to own a military Humvee for display or recreation. It's simple. All you have to do is visit winahumvee.com and register today. It's that easy. Don't wait. Register today at winahumvee.com. Winahumvee.com is being brought to you by GovPlanet, your online auction site for government surplus.
Welcome.
Hi.
Today we're going to be comparing the roll-formed, high-strength steel bed of the Chevy Silverado to the aluminum bed of this competitor's truck.
Nice.
You want to grab that empty toolbox for me? Let's start here with the aluminum bed.
That's a big hole.
Huge.
We got Swiss cheese for a truck here.
I'm curious to see if that will do the same thing with the Chevy.
Well, let's find out. Same spot, same angle, same empty toolbox.
Took it way better.
The steel held up.
Silverado proved it is the toughest truck here.
If you're in the market for military surplus for recreation or construction, or you just want to own a piece of military history, go online to GovPlanet.com's weekly auction. GovPlanet has auctions every Wednesday, where you can find and bid on numerous items. All items are protected by ironclad assurance, which makes sure that what's in GovPlanet's report is what you're getting. Be sure to join GovPlanet every Wednesday for their weekly auction, and check in often to see their ever-changing inventory. GovPlanet, your online auction site for government equipment. Northside, performance outdoor footwear for the whole family.
Roger that.
Well, on this segment of Military Collectors this week, we are inside the radio control room of the RC tank battles, okay, right here at the American Armor Foundation Tank Museum in Danville, Virginia, and the expert, our radio controlled tank battle driver, you name it, the guy that loves it the most, is the brother to Dan, who you've seen on the show. And Dan showed us Doug about all this, man, but he said, Doug, my brother, is the tank guy.
Yeah, he says I am.
Well, tell me about these. I mean, this is neat. Okay, as a kid, I used to build these things, okay, mm-hmm. But not like this.
No, not like this. We call these a little bit more big boy toys. What we do here is we designed a battlefield here. We got into it. A gentleman came towards us and asked us if we'd be interested in doing something like this. And we said, yeah, we'd be interested in doing this thing and see what it's all about. So we gave it a try, and it turned out to be extremely, extremely popular for us. So what we did is we got into the hobby of selling these tanks. They're Tamiya 1/16 tanks. We stock them, we sell them in our store and all that stuff. And people can come and buy these, build them, and bring them out on the battlefield and battle infrared battles.
Well, listen, I know that, of course, the Tank Museum here is all about events, and you guys do that throughout the year, but this is a big deal. You guys hold 4 public tank battle events throughout the year.
Yeah, it's a big draw for us. Definitely brings in the crowd. We used to have tank groupies, what I can say, and people used to come and cheer us on.
Well, this is a whole different aspect of military collectibles. I mean, you got to think about it. I mean, okay, what's the average price of, and probably low end, of this tank?
To get in the hobby, you're looking at about $800, but that would be everything you would need. Once you go from that step up, you still have some of the items that you would need for the next vehicle, so it would be a little bit more inexpensive.
Okay.
$800 is about the starting price.
All right, well, now, show me a little bit about what's inside one of these Hummers.
Okay. This one's very simple to get into. It just clips on the sides, and you just pull it right off. And then you see all the internals. Basically, it's a computer on tracks, right? You got electronic boards in here, speakers, the receiver from the radio system, the battery system, and my drive motors. And then you also have here in the backside, rotation unit, the rotation for the turret, and then you have an elevation and flash unit in there as well.
Okay, so obviously it doesn't shoot a projectile, but you're shooting what, laser flash?
Yeah, it's infrared. You're shooting an infrared beam.
Okay, and that's basically like the military uses in part of their training harnesses where shoot me and I'm dead
right.
if I go off.
Right, exact same thing, yep.
Well, how does it work?
Well, basically, I'll show you right here. Want me to start them up for you?
Yeah.
Okay, well, this is what the radio looks like. Standard in RC hobby, everybody uses them. Mostly come down from airplanes. So just turn that on there. What you're gonna hear is when I turn this on, you can hear the startup sound from the tank. That's real startup sound from a Sherman tank.
That's awesome.
Yep. Wow. Now what I can do is I'll show you, go through the function and show you how it works. So right here, I got drive, you got the forward,
okay.
You got the back, of course, and then your pivot sounds and all that stuff. You can do it in different progressives. What I have here is my turret. You got my left and my right. You got my elevation and my depression. And then when I want to fire, I got this button right here. I just push that button, and you saw the flash come out of there.
Yeah.
This one's set up as a classification medium tank. There's different classifications for these tanks. You got heavy, medium, and light. And they have different amounts of hits that they can take and fire as well.
I mean, can I actually, a novice, drive this thing?
Yes, you can.
Really?
Yes, you can. It's not very hard. They're slow because they're 2-scale for 1/16. So they're not crazy fast like commercial cars or airplanes.
Wow. What? Let's put him down, okay? Let's see what we do.
All right. Put him back down
here,
on our
field. I'll get the controller for you. Look at this. And again, the battlefield, you guys custom made this thing.
Yeah, we built this battlefield all ourselves. People said it couldn't be done. We pulled it off in a couple months. It's always changing to keep the battles different all the time.
Right.
We don't want people to get used to certain protective areas, better objectives, all that stuff. So we always change the field every time we battle.
Okay. All right, so what's the objective of the battle? I mean, is the line of departures, and I mean, where the enemy all poised, and how do you guys stage that?
It can be done lots of different ways. The basic way that normally is done is you have Axis and Allies. It doesn't necessarily have to be Axis and Allies. It can be flags or no flags.
Okay.
So if we don't have the right amount of people, we can make that work with flags and no flags.
Gotcha.
We divide the field into four quadrants, the center line, and then the center line the other way.
Okay.
You can start off in a zone, so we pick zones each time. We usually start opposite zones. So this is zone 4, that's zone 3. We could start in those zones. When we say go, that's where you start off of and go.
Okay, so go.
All right, so you can just see how it drives around. You hear the sound? You can hear the sound as the engine revs up?
That is awesome.
You hear the turret when I'm turning?
Now, operating time of the batteries?
The batteries I got in there, I can go about 5-6 battles.
No kidding.
Yeah. You hear the firing of the gun. You saw the recoil of the tank as well.
Yeah.
When your gun shoots, the tank jerks a little bit.
It jerks back?
Yes, sir. And then when it gets hit, it also will jerk backwards.
Really?
Yeah. Let's see it dry
out. I mean, you've even got mud out there. Look at that. Although it's not that sticky.
We have to water the battlefield. We used to not to, and you would actually get about 3 to 6 inches of sand built up in the corners.
Ah.
And they would actually bog the tanks down so much you would start breaking tracks, gearboxes, just like a real tank would.
That is awesome. Is that kind of the max speed?
That's max speed right there. We're set up for on-road speed per our classifications here at the museum. You can go faster if you want, but we try to keep it all the same for all participants. And the battlefield is basically 60 by 100. You can shoot an infrared beam way longer than that, and you can shoot on the other side of this building if you want to, depending on the lights that you have. The lighting affects infrared, So we try to have it kind of dark and out of the sunlight, and it definitely helps out the battle system work better.
That is absolutely the most unique thing I've ever seen.
Now the tank will also slow down. If I took a couple hits, I would have reduced power. It would get so much reduced at the end of my life that I would have a hard time climbing up the hills,
right,
the rocks, all the features.
Almost like real.
Like the real thing, yes sir.
That's neat. That is neat. How many people normally play at each event?
On average, it's 15, and we have all the way up to 45.
Wow.
And it's typically in the 20 plus range.
Well, Doug, listen, I am so impressed. I can see why you're Mr. Mr. Remote Control Tank Battle King.
Oh, yeah, it's a lot
okay?
of fun.
How many of you won?
We've all won and lost.
Oh,
part
okay.
of war. You got to
okay.
take the good and you
now,
gotta
who's
take the bad.
Best, you or Brother Dan?
I'd say myself.
Okay, well, that's what I'm talking about. Don't be modest. Well, I'll tell you what, let me see if I can't drive this thing a little bit. Look at that thing. Oh, my gosh. And it turns.
Yep, it'll climb right up those hills.
Look at that.
And rocks. Even though it's a model kit, it's actually a very resilient kit. Since you're building it just like a model, you got to paint it. Bolt it all together. You have to grease and oil. You have gearboxes you have to build.
That's neat.
It's definitely a lot of fun.
That is fantastic, I will tell you. Thank you all so right. much. Folks, I tell you what, log on AAF Tank Museum. Go to militarycollectorstv.com. You want to be a part of one of these really neat indoor remote control tank battles? This is a place to come. And oh, by the way, you don't even have to come with your own tank. You can get it when you get here. Man, I'll tell you what. All right, come on, go fire and shoot them up.
All right.
For more information on the AAF Tank Museum in Danville, Virginia, visit them online at aaftankmuseum.com and schedule your trip to see 300,000 square feet of tank history.
Well, that's our episode this week of Military Collectors. I'd like to thank all the guys and gals who made this week's show possible up in Danville, Virginia at the American Armor Foundation Tank Museum. Again, radio control tanks, I mean generals' uniforms, Rommel. Hey, look, I don't have an RC control tank. The best that I can do today is, hey, Doug, crank her up, though. Man, I'm ready to go on out. We're going to go to my battlefield and play with the big boy toys. We'll see you next week on Military Collectors.